Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Jamie Kirsch. I'm a senior lecturer of music here at Tufts. It's wonderful to see you all for the first colloquium of this strange fall 2020 semester. But we're so delighted to welcome David Coleman here and to keep our colloquia going. And we're so happy that David's presentation will lead us off. Okay, it's my pleasure to welcome David Coleman. This talk is called Feminism, Theater, the Church, and the Power of the Female Voice. David Freeman Coleman earned his Bachelor of Music degree in Piano Performance and Music Composition from BU, Boston University, and his Master of Arts in Music Composition from Tufts University. David is the Director of Choral Music at the Dana Hall School in Wellesley, the Minister of Music at the Greater Framingham Community Church, Associate Professor of Theater at the Boston Conservatory at Berkeley, and of course, Lecturer of Music and Director of the 225-voice Tufts University Gospel Choir. Actively involved in theater and gospel music throughout the greater Boston area, David has served as music director and rehearsal pianist for several productions, including the 2012 Tony Award-winning production of the Gershwin's Porgy and Bess, and choir boy at Speakeasy Stage, for which he received an Elliot Norton Award nomination for Outstanding Musical Direction. An active songwriter and composer, he has recorded 10 CDs of choral music and original works, and in 2013, David received awards for Best Male Gospel Artist and Best Gospel CD at the New England Urban Music Awards. David has worked with choirs for Mariah Carey, Bobby McFerrin, Patti LaBelle, Phish, and Academy Award nominee Ryan Gosling, including performances at the White House, Carnegie Hall, and the Vatican. Originally from Memphis, Tennessee, David has lived in Boston most of his life and currently resides in Norfolk, Mass. With his wife, daughter, and two dogs. It is my great pleasure to welcome David Coleman.
Thank you, Jamie. Hello, everybody. My name is David Freeman Coleman, and I am a lecturer of music at Tufts University, as you just heard, where I earned my master's degree in composition in 2001. Since then, I've become the director of the large gospel choir Tufts, and as well as the director of choral music at Dana Hall. You heard that I work as a minister of music. I'm at a church in Framingham, and I'm the music director for professional theater all around town. All of those experiences, my work as a composer, a gospel choir musician, a theater music director, and a choir director with more than 20 years of experience with female voices, that I present this topic to you today: feminism, the church, theater, and the power of the female voice. As a male exploring the world of the female voice, I'll explain how I came to name this presentation by recounting how I began to consider myself a feminist. Today, it is my personal belief that all men should consider themselves feminists. I was raised by a woman. My spouse is a woman. We have a daughter, and I teach at an all-girls school. It's essential that I live a life sensitive to the experiences, victories, and struggles of women. But until 10 years ago, I would not have called myself a feminist. In 2011, I saw a documentary entitled Misrepresentation, created by actress Jennifer Siebel Newsom, and it focused on how women are portrayed in the media. Studies show that in movies, TV, book, magazine, and other print media, 90% of it displays female imagery, and much of it is centered around their outward appearance. This has been studied and shown to have a dramatic effect on how girls view themselves, the biggest problem being that their worth, their value, is in their physical appearance. And that has a direct effect on their participation in school, their ambition in pursuing careers, and their psychological and spiritual self-evaluation. Here is the trailer from the documentary, which was a 2011 Sundance Film Festival official selection.
The media is the message and the messenger, and increasingly a powerful one.
In a world of a million channels, People try to do more shocking and shocking things to break through the clutter. They resort to violent images or sexually offensive images or demeaning images.
When is it gonna be enough?
There is no appreciation for women intellectuals. It's all about the body, not about the brain.
You all saw the photo from the weekend of Hillary looking so haggard and what, looking like 92 years old. Breast implants, did you have them or not?
If you waterboarded Nancy Pelosi, she wouldn't admit to plastic surgery.
The fact that media are so derogatory to the most powerful women in the country, then what does it say about media's ability to take any woman in America seriously?
I have close friends that will go to the bathroom and put on like 10 pounds of makeup, you know, and you're at school to learn.
I remember fifth grade, I was worrying about my weight, and now I'm in ninth grade, I'm still worrying about my weight.
As a culture, women are brought up to be fundamentally insecure.
Media creates consciousness, and if what gets put out there that creates our consciousness is determined by men, we're not gonna make any progress.
Little boys and little girls, when they're 7 years old, an equal number want to be president of the United States when they grow up. But then you ask the same question when they're 15, and you see this massive gap emerging.
We're shortchanging voices that are urgently needed in public forums from ever getting to the table.
As the most powerful country in the world, if you're not standing for the right values and for the right principles, that's a loss for the world.
You get a woman in the Oval Office, most powerful person in the world, what's the downside?
You mean besides the PMS and the mood swings?
The media treats women like shit, and it's horrible, and it's like, I don't know how we survive it. I don't know how we rise above it. I tremble.
You can't be what you can't see.
It's extremely important for women to be writing their own stories and giving them to people to really emotionally become impacted by.
The media can be an instrument of change. It can awaken people and change minds. It depends on who's piloting the plane.
The end of this movie poses a question. What can you do to make a difference? And my original thought was, you know, as a man, am I not part of the problem? However, just as racism will never end without the work and advocacy from white people, sexism will never end without the work and advocacy of men. And I realized that I could proudly call myself a feminist simply because I believe in equal opportunity for and equal treatment of women. I also realized that one of the things that I could do to make a difference is use my position of influence as a teacher, a choral director, and a composer to direct my students at the Dana Hall School, which is an all-girls school, to these issues and help spread the message beyond the parameter of a one-on-one conversation. So I wrote a song based on the title of that movie, Misrepresentation. I combined the choirs in the middle school and the upper school, wrote a part for strings, collaborated with the director of dance to create choreography, and I had students and faculty participate in a spoken word section of the song. It was an interdisciplinary arts performance. Please watch this video from its world premiere.
Oh.
will write novels with women as central figures or protagonists.
I will film movies with fully realized three-dimensional female characters.
I will publish news stories about the causes and daily achievements by women and girls.
I will create art that celebrates our inner as well as our outer beauty.
I will tell someone younger than me that her value is much more than what the media portrays.
I will speak out against injustice and speak truth to power.
I've been the director of choral music at the Dana Hall School for almost 20 years. From my very first week at that job, I was writing original music for the school to sing and for my choirs to learn. It's been a great resource for me as a composer to always have a choir on hand ready to learn anything I was writing. And of course, I found myself writing more and more for young women's voices. I've written more than 25 original works for treble choir, and I've arranged hundreds more. But why? What is it about the female voice that's so alluring? I used to theorize that because most of us had mothers or mother figures in our lives, they imprint their voices in our minds. Arguably the first voices we recall hearing even in the womb, and possibly the last voice we would hear at night before going to sleep, either reading us a story or singing a lullaby, would be from a female voice. But that psychological, emotional connection aside, it is more than that. The American Speech Language Hearing Association, known as ASHA, recently published an article about the general differences in male and female voices entitled The Unheard Female Voice. Here's an excerpt from that article by Stephanie Watson. In general, women speak at a higher pitch, about an octave higher than men. An adult woman's average range is from 165 to 255 hertz, while a man's is 85 to 155 hertz. Men's voices are generally deeper because the surge of testosterone released during puberty causes their vocal cords to elongate and thicken. Like the strings of a cello, thicker, longer vocal cords produce a deeper sound. Lower pitched voices give the impression of being louder because they have more resonance. With women's voices being higher pitched, they don't carry as far, says Amy Shaw, associate professor and director of the Cross-Cultural Speech and Language and Acoustics Lab in Stockton University School of Health Sciences. Not only can these characteristics make women's voices harder to hear, she says, but when women try to emphasize a point, they sometimes raise their pitch even more, which can sound harsh or jarring. In this vein, a 2012 study published in PLOS ONE found that both men and women prefer male and female leaders who have lower pitched voices across a variety of fields, from more stereotypically masculine fields to more stereotypically feminine ones. Women also have a larger gap at the back of their vocal cords, which allows more air to pass through. This gives women's voices more of a breathy quality than men's voices. The combination of higher pitch and breathiness can make women's voices more challenging to hear, especially for older adults with age-related hearing loss, in which high-frequency sounds diminish first. There is a gigantic however to be placed here. While these studies go on to show that people prefer lower, louder voices for people in positions of leadership and authority, and that disproportionately men are found to interrupt women while talking to them rather than vice versa. Science will also show that the characteristics of the female voice when used in song reveal some clues as to why we're so taken with the sound of the female singing voice. These images from Purdue University show a graphic representation of sound files of a man screaming, that's the top graphic, and a woman screaming, the bottom graphic. You'll note that in both graphs, the x-axis represents the different sound frequencies that we experience and some of the ones that our ears can't detect. The female voice covers more frequencies than the male voice and more intensely at that. In other words, the female voice has the opportunity to appeal to and affect us in ways the male voice cannot. In order for a woman to scream, she has to put forth a lot of physical effort. And it would seem that when the voice is raised above that of speaking, therein lies the power, the dominant power of her voice. However dominant as it may be, history has proven that the female voice has been suppressed and even banned altogether in the home, the workplace, our houses of worship, and in the entertainment industry. In fact, the two areas of great struggle I would like to focus on are the theater and the church. Saying the names of these two institutions naturally spark images that are very different. However, they do share a lot in common. Both places are where large crowds gather in order to witness a few speak and sing. Both places can be viewed as casual or as very formal, depending on time and place. Both presentations follow a script or a structure of rituals, and both have a long history of male dominance in the vocal participation of their ceremonies and performances. When we study the history of women in music, we learn that the earliest musicians that are referenced in documents and in art were women. Women were the percussionists, leaders in sacred ritual, and there are thousands and thousands of images from artwork from the Middle East, Egypt, India, China, Greece, and in Europe in the time before the Middle Ages that show it was a global practice. However, during the rise of Christianity in Europe in the Middle Ages, we begin to see systematic removal of women's participation in music and the religious ceremony altogether. During this time, the Roman Catholic Church became larger than a faith-based religion, but it became a driving force of social, culture, and government. It's no secret that both government and the church had a male-dominant patriarchy. And even though women played a role in the attendance and the building of the church, their voices were not allowed in the practice of the services. The Christian rationale for the silencing of women's voices is often the Bible. 1 Timothy 2 chapter verse 12 says, I do not permit a woman to teach or to exercise authority over a man. Rather, she is to remain quiet. And 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verse 34 says, the women should keep silent in the churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but should be in submission, as the law also says. But of course, like most religions, it's not the scripture, but rather the context and the application of scripture that's dangerous. This same book, the Bible, that references slaves and their masters was used as justification for slavery in America. While in that very same book, the Bible, God delivers the Hebrew slaves from bondage in one of the most famous told miracles of the parting of the Red Sea. Even the first story of Adam and Eve can be used as a rationale for derision and negative attention on women as influencers, tempters, or even evil itself. Those who would use these scriptures references to silence women simultaneously ignore the context that women were not allowed a formal education, as well as the many other Bible stories where women not only speak, but speak with authority. Miriam, Deborah, Mary, Martha, and more, as well as the book of Acts, which says your sons and daughters will prophesy. Nevertheless, this patriarchal culture of prohibition persisted for more than 1,000 years. Dr. Laura Pritchard, a noted musicologist, writes extensively on the history of women and song and outlines a history of the church's decisions. In 379 ACE, the Synod of Antioch declares that women and men could not sing together in the same melody. So congregations were divided into men singing alone and women and children singing alone. This process was called antiphonia. There were singing schools that were established devoted to only the training of male voices. And in 578 ACE, the Synod of Auxerre declared restrictions on the women's attire, as well as banned girls from singing altogether. And several popes later, years later, forbade female choirs, while boys' choirs became more and more the norm for the culture all the way into the Renaissance. Here is arguably the most famous composer from the Renaissance period, Palestrina, as performed by my chamber choir at the Dana Hall School. This is Illumina Oculos Meos, which means enlighten my eyes. With boys' choirs, the patriarchal church were having their proverbial cake and eating it too. They would enjoy the much-needed sonorities found in treble singing without having females participate. The emergence of the castrato voice also provided this outlet for what easily could have been described as a feminine sound. However, we begin to see the church and composers of church music introduce female sopranos into the art form during the Baroque era. Why the shift? We will come back to that after we explore another area of struggle for today's topic. It's commonly known that in the theater, they have a long history of male dominance, male playwrights, male directors, and male actors even playing the female roles themselves. This practice goes back to ancient Greece and Rome. Here's a part of a documentary from the National Theater about women's role in theater.
In ancient 5th century Athens, women were sometimes seen, definitely not heard. They were really, really sort of low down in the pecking order. So it's really strange then when we go to pieces of theatre created at this time and see so many strong women being portrayed on stage.
Plays were written by men, entirely performed by men, and the audiences were all men. And they were being performed to in a society and in a social hierarchy that treated women as an underclass. And yet, the subject matter is these stories of women of incredible power, in Antigone or Electra or Medea, these women with huge personalities, great strength, great intelligence, great emotional intelligence, fighting back against the patriarchy.
Actually, in Greek theatre, it is extraordinary how many powerful women there are in that. There's powerful goddesses, there's, you know, Clytemnestra, there's all these amazing women.
So while society in ancient Athens was pretty misogynistic, definitely, in, you know, deeply patriarchal, but also we have some fantastic examples of sources, other sources around the time talking about how annoying women are. There's a fragment from a different tragedy that says it's better to bury a woman than to marry her. So set in that kind of context, it does seem very strange that we have all of these wonderful female characters on stage. But I think to do the Athenians some justice, they did recognize how important women were. And even though women didn't necessarily have a political voice and they wouldn't necessarily be allowed out of a house that much, they would have been recognized as performing two, in particular, key roles for the city. First of all, they created children. Secondly, women often were really, really important for the running of the city's religious festivals. And in tragedy, we see that tension between recognizing women are important and needing to control and subdue women worked out. So we get a character like Medea. She is manifestly intelligent, fantastically loyal. She has done everything that a wife should do. She produced two sons. And yet she's been cast off, put to one side. And this is something that Athenians would have been aware of and might have wanted to say, okay, so here's the situation, what might happen? How can we talk about this problem? Because we can't talk about it in real life, we have to talk about it in the theatre, in this safe sort of space. Similarly, in the Antigone, you have a woman who is doing exactly what women should be doing. She's making sure that the body of her brother is correctly buried. That is a religious imperative and something that women in particular were responsible for. And the fact that she is trying to do this duty and she's being thwarted in that by the most important man in the city is a really, really difficult question. How do you reconcile that? So they try and work out these tensions by putting them on stage.
The writers were great writers and they recognised that it's in the marginalised voices, the oppressed voices, the people who are trying to strike back against power that the best stories can come and that the most emotionally affecting stories can come. And I think, you know, Sophocles, Aeschylus and Euripides were brilliant in the way that they perceived that. And as I say, not in a society where those stories were by any means at the forefront of people's consciousnesses, but to find those stories and take them and force them into them.
Like the church, Greek culture viewed women involved in a role on display to a crowd to be dangerous. It seems the only questions that mattered were, how will men respond to this? Or what if she influences them to think like she does? Also, like with church history, obviously I don't have the time to go through the entire series of events of how women eventually did take the stage, but here is a highlight showing that there is indeed a connection between the church, the theater, and the female voice. While no woman appeared on the ancient stage, it is noted that during the mid-10th century, when the influence of the Christian church and its culture dominated Europe, that theater itself had remained formulaic and serious. There was, however, a dramatic renaissance from a playwright in Germany who wrote in Latin and created what was then known as the comedic play. That playwright was a woman. That playwright was also a nun, Rosvita. Here's a quick video about her.
Rosvita was born in Saxony around the 10th century. We do know Rosvita's name literally means strong honor, but she decided it meant something more like the clarion call or the loud cry. At some point, she joined the convent at Gandersheim as a canoness, giving her the freedom to own property, keep servants. She studied under two women at the convent, including the abbess, and became exceptionally well-read. Moreover, she read diversely. The Bible, sure, and the writings of the church fathers and the non-canonical gospels, but also contemporary histories and secular Latin greats, too, like Ovid and Virgil. She even read our old friends Plautus and Terence, but those comedies were a little troubling for Rosvita. So much lewd behavior. So she decided to write her own versions. In addition to plays, she also wrote verse legends and histories, one about Otto I, the Holy Roman Emperor, and another about her own convent, all of them in careful meter. She's the first playwright of the Middle Ages. Care to guess what theme might interest a nun who has made herself a bride of Christ? That's right, chastity. If Terence is going to write about the shameless acts of licentious women, Rosvita is going to write about virgins, and also unchaste ladies who repent and embrace chastity. Basically, it's just a little bit of medieval slut-shaming. It's clear that love and sex fascinate Rosvita. In her preface, she blushes to admit her work has forced her to think about the dreadful frenzy of those possessed by unlawful love and the insidious sweetness of passion. Things which should not even be named among us. But she argues that only by coming to grips with lust can she demonstrate how much more wonderful the divine succor is of those who resist it. Whether or not Rosvita's works were performed has been the subject of debate. Most scholars believe that Rosvita wrote her plays to be read, a genre we call closet dramas. After all, that's how she encountered Terence's plays, in book form, not on stage. It's probable that her work was read aloud, and remotely possible that it was performed privately in the medieval period. But since the late 19th century, her plays have been performed pretty often. It's worth noting that this emphasis on chastity suggests it was one of a very few ways that women could wield power in the Middle Ages, but this is likely more of a concern for present-day readers.
What a great irony that the rebirth of theater sprang from the church and from a woman. And why not? Often the voices of the oppressed are the most passionate and the loudest, if we're listening. Which brings me to the connection of the moment when women were finally allowed on stage, both in the theater and in the sanctuaries of the churches. Ta-da! Opera. There is a direct connection to the emergence of opera in the 17th century and the composers writing not only female roles, but demanding females play them. This was true both on stage and in sacred works that the very same composers would write for the church. You see, composers who were almost all male began to exercise their influence and their voices to make room for female voices. As composers began to write more for female choirs and works for the stage that featured the female singing voice, the trend began to increase. Castrati and boys' choirs, while they hold a place in the firmament of music, were no longer seen as a substitute for the rich and unparalleled beauty and tone of the female voice. However, it must be noted that opera is theater, and women were not only singing songs, they were acting out stories on stage. And the sky did not fall. Not only were women empowered to be a part of their own stories, the myths of the dangers of women on the stage were expelled, for some. It certainly was not a quick overnight fix, but it is noteworthy that the repertoire of plays, musicals, and religious music featuring female performers we enjoy today is fairly young in comparison with the histories of these two genres. However, I do like to reflect that opera, composers, and nuns saved the day in true Revenge of the Nerds style. Now that we've covered a bit of feminism and how the church and the theater helped indoctrinate a culture to restrict displays of female authority, let's celebrate the female voice and how we as composers can use it as a compositional tool. One of the great features of the female voice is its ability to pair with many of the orchestral instruments. These are the brass, the strings, and the woodwinds. The female voice is all of those instruments all in one. And not only in sound, the variety of potential timbres and intensities also help communicate the full palette of human emotion in the most effective way possible. Even before I considered myself a feminist, when I was ignorant to the history that I've shared with you today, I knew that the female voice was a force to be reckoned with and absolutely was the sword in my arsenal to deliver messages through my music. As a composer of gospel music, I realized early on that I favored the use of the female voice. In 2013, I won 2 New England Urban Music Awards for my album entitled The Jesus is the Man Project, which I worked on for about 20 years with church choirs, school gospel choirs, including Tufts, and musician friends. Of the 10 songs, all of them begin with women's voices. Here's a quick sample of some of those voices.
My longings as now.
female voice covers all of the sounds and all of the emotions that you could ever want. Innocence, power, strength, fear, as well as sound brassy, as well as sound as smooth as strings, or as simple and innocent as woodwinds. And I'm not alone. Composers have been doing this for centuries. When we study the history of blues, though, in R&B and gospel, we find that clearly the female voices are the most celebrated and influential. From Ma Rainey to Ella Fitzgerald to Mahalia Jackson to Aretha Franklin and Yolanda Adams, who's not pictured here. And while, of course, there are male singers who have contributed greatly to those genres, there is an essence of royalty when we celebrate the divas of the art form. And it's poetic justice that they be the stars in a world where historically they have been and continue to be denied so much. Here is a brief mashup of gospel music from the last 60 years that help explain why it would help create the illusion that female voices have always been at the front of the church, leading us in song. Our God is an awesome God, he reigns. Gospel music is so passionate and powerful that it borders on theatrical, and there are several theatrical elements to be found in the church. Likewise, a theater can be so passionate and powerful that it has spiritual elements. Here are some brief iconic moments from musical theater that highlight the use of the female voice to invoke spiritual experiences.
Sometimes I wonder where
Oh,
so powerful. And this is where we find the great irony. Even today in some churches, women are not accepted as preachers. And the Catholic Church worldwide does not allow women to become priests. However, in all denominations, women are allowed to sing, which is arguably more effective and influential in spreading religious messages. Therefore, it takes more than protests and speeches in order to restore the balance to the appreciation of the gift of the female voice. It takes creating equal opportunities in a world where inequality is the norm. This is the idea behind feminism, not the belief that women are the same as men or better than men, but the recognition that they deserve the same opportunities as men and certainly the same treatment, compensation, and justice under the law. This is not a difficult concept in theory, but it is very difficult in execution. In fact, the struggles of Black people in America often parallel with those of women. The right to vote, the right for fair wages, and the resistance of objectification and negative stereotypes in media, as we discussed today. I am proud to say that I'm a feminist, and as a man, I have a responsibility to own my male privilege and acknowledge the perspective of those who are suffering in ways that I am not. In the same way, a white person proclaiming to be an anti-racist has a responsibility to own their white privilege and acknowledge the perspective of those who are suffering in ways that they are not. The playwright Jenny Lynn Bader said that we live in a world dominated by the male imagination. If that's true, then it is ever more the time for men to take up arms and join in the fight and not just create art featuring female voices, but creating opportunities for them to speak for themselves. My life experiences have revealed to me the need for feminism and the connections between the church and the theater, and that work continues. I am working on a large live concert presentation highlighting the connections between theater and the church, as well as writing a full-length musical featuring all female voices. I will close with a perfect union of the church and theater, known as the musical Sister Act, where Tony Award winner Patina Miller leads the Sisters of the Convent in Raise Your Voice, showing that indeed the female voice, when raised, is a force like no other.
Gloria de Patria!
Amen!
Thank you, everyone, for showing up today. Thank you to Tufts University. Thank you to the Department of Music and the Colloquium Committee. And thank you to the Dana Hall School for allowing me to give this presentation during the day today. All right, that's it. Thank you, everybody. I believe that Jamie's going to come back and see if anybody has any questions.
Yes, thank you so much. In fact, there we go. Perfect. You should feel free. I think you should all be able to unmute yourselves and mute yourselves. We can certainly all unmute and give a round of applause for that. I think that would be great. All right. Thank you so much, everybody. That was really wonderful. Thank you, David, so much. We have until 1:15 for questions, comments, and I will simply facilitate and call on people. So if you would, in the participants, you can raise that little blue hand there, and I'll just keep an eye out for those and call on people and send them over to you, David, and we'll try to keep it moving with any questions and comments.
Cool. Of course, no one has questions because I covered it all.
Roslyn.
Hi, David. Thank you. What a wonderful presentation. I just love that connection between the church, kind of the evolution of the voice in the church, the voice in theater, and kind of merging in opera. And, you know, it's something I never really noticed, but now it seems very apparent. So when you're looking at that and you see that transition, what do you think is the strongest connection for you? Do you think it's, you know, there's a textual connection, there's the drama. What most appeals to you as you're writing your pieces, these interconnections between the disciplines?
As a composer, when you're writing a piece of music, you know that you're going to have an audience that's forced to listen to your ideas. And so you want to make sure that those ideas are worth listening to so that they'll continue to listen and that they'll come back and listen for more. I believe that power that composers have is unbridled and unchecked. And if a composer is good enough, they can change the world. And it's not just the music, it's who's presenting the music. That choice that opera composers made to force the establishment to involve women and allow them to sing their own parts changed everything. It was the composer, it was the music, it was the fact that musicians live in the secular world and in the sacred world simultaneously, especially in the Europe in the 18th century. They had the power, just like the Black church musician would play in a club on a Saturday night and then play at church on Sunday and then combine the two, gospel music. You know, gospel music only exists because the musician who created it lived in both worlds, played music in both worlds, presented music in both worlds, and saw the connection. And restoring this balance between the sacred and the divine, I mean, the secular and the divine, is basically what happened with opera. And the connective tissue was the artist, the composer, who had the authority to do that. Also, a bridge between the theater and the church is the fact that they're both places that we go to see mirrors of ourselves. The theater, we go to see plays because they're telling stories, not just of people and representations we don't know, because it's definitely for that. But also in those stories, even with representations of people we don't normally see on stage, we see ourselves, because there is a human connection between random different stories that you don't know, and you see yourself in those stories. We learn more about ourselves, we become better versions of ourselves. Isn't that the reason people go to church? They go there to not just praise God and to worship, but they go to become the best version of themselves, which is what the gifts of praise and worship promise us, is that we're becoming more like our creator. I think the desire for the congregation or the audience to be better is why we go to the theater and why we go to church. And that's also part of that connection, why they're kind of hand in hand.
Thank you so much. Next question from Fady Coleman.
I know that name.
Hi. Great job. Thank you so much for that wonderful presentation. I just have more of a comment and perhaps a small question. So one, I think it's really important that you shared how you bring these concepts and these perspectives into the classroom, because I think that is important. And I think that's part of the role we serve as educators, is also to help make these things aware. And I just wanted to ask a little bit about what would you recommend for others that want to do something similar? I think any discipline would benefit from that. And so do you have any suggestions or takeaways as to how to implement that strategically? Thank you.
That's a great question. And just like composers have great power to choose what people listen to, teachers have even more power than composers. Teachers have your students, your children's attention and ear under the authority of the federal government. You have to listen to what I say. You have to repeat what I say. You have to do tests on what I say. You have to pass those tests on what I say. And a teacher that recognizes their power can use that to a greater good by, you know, creating lessons that are not only informative, but exciting. It sounds, of course, it's very easy to say, and it's hard to manage consistently. But I find that if a teacher never loses the idea that they're always a student and constantly learning, just like presenting this colloquium today helped me take things that I kind of knew or had ideas about and focus them into this 45 minutes, it's of great benefit to other people, the weeks and weeks of work that I spent doing that. And that's what teachers need to realize, is that it's not simply regurgitating things in a textbook. It's finding new connections, finding new ways of presenting things and being exciting. And then your students become the luckiest people on the planet, because they know that they're getting something unique that's only for them from that teacher. Unless, of course, you're on Zoom and you can talk to 200 people at the same time, which is what we're experiencing now.
Thank you. That's great.
Thank you.
Other questions or comments? David, there are a couple of people who wrote things in the chat. If you can just, we could see those too. But also other questions are most welcome. Someone, RL Cheek, about what's happening politically at the time to support this. Can you see those chats? But also anybody, if they'd like to raise their hand, we'd be happy to continue.
When you study feminism, when you study women, particularly in music, it's amazing that women actually did participate heavily in the process of musical worship, and because they led the rituals. In fact, and I'm not speaking of Christianity, I'm speaking of other pagan religions outside of Christianity that are referred to as pagan. Women were leaders, and that power that they had to participate, and almost uniformly women participated in the leading of worship. There was no need for a political uprising. It wasn't until Christianity became not just a religion, but became part of the societal culture and, you know, influencing the government itself, that these rules and these things changed for women. But, you know, of course, it's not as simple as blaming it on the church. It is, as you saw in the history of theater, women weren't allowed on stage. Women have been, labeled with this dangerous notion that they're going to influence or do something to make men think, you know, impure thoughts, so we can't have them on display. But, you know, the actual feminist movement as we know it today didn't begin, in any kind of real force until the suffrage movement for the right to vote. Before that, it was just women trying to make it through and make the best of their situation. And in every single example that you can read historically where a woman rose above the fray, It's because of education. It's because she found a way to get an education. She found a way to learn how to read for herself. And reading things helped people, individuals, rise above their station or what their limitations were. Without that, in fact, Roswitha that we saw today, the only reason that she knew how to write plays is because she was reading them and because she was taught to. And that's the thing. And I don't know if that's so much of a political movement, but there's no way to have a political movement without writing and reading. And if women aren't allowed to have an education, there's no politics. So writing and sharing information, when the printing press and pamphlets and things like that started becoming a thing, that's when we started seeing women actually speaking out for these changes. But of course, being that it was a almost 100% male patriarchy, those voices were considered fringe and some considered them ridiculous. Even as recent as if you watch the Netflix movie Enola Holmes, which is set in England during the time of Sherlock Holmes, imagining that he had a little sister. The setting for the movie is the beginning of what we know as women's rights and the Reformation and trying to get women the right to vote. And all the male characters in the movie are like, can you believe what's happening in this country? The country's going to hell. You know, what are they talking about? This is ridiculous. Some were laughing it off. Some were getting upset about it. That's what they had to deal with. And yet still women persisted. Thank God. And, you know, they're still waging that fight today through different waves of feminism. But the idea, the original idea of feminism is still what I hold to. And I don't, and the original wave of feminism was thought to have passed after they got the right to vote. And people, they thought that the movement died down, when in truth, the passage of the right to vote didn't eliminate sexism, and it certainly didn't rescue women from their stations altogether. It was just one issue. And it was very difficult to keep that movement alive because some women were very complacent in the way things were and fought against feminism. So just like people fought, just like Black people fought against civil rights, you know, everybody wasn't marching on Washington. Everybody wasn't saying, I have a dream. Some of them were like, you know, this is crazy. You're getting us more hurt and more killed by rocking the boat. You know, we should just be peaceful. And of course, change doesn't happen peacefully all the time. And you have to make people upset and upset the system. And that's what had to happen then, still needs to happen now. But it's definitely been a slow burn. And it really didn't start until around the time mass publications were allowed to be disseminated. It was just whispers in private up until then.
New question from Stephanie.
Hi.
Hi.
So I have a question for you about how you think about the conflict of our time with, it's almost like God has been replaced by rational thought, or I don't know, so-called rational thought. And a lot of people just cannot relate to speaking about the divine or communion with the divine or anything that has anything to do with so-called supernatural stuff, right? So how do you, as someone who is clearly spirit, I mean, I believe you must be spiritual if you're writing music Yep. that celebrates the divine. How do you, what do you say? I mean, I don't need to know exactly what you say directly to those people, but in your heart, what do you say to those people who just think it's all nonsense?
Of course. Number one, you can't change a person's mind. The only thing that changes a person's mind is their own individual life experience. However, if they come into my circle of influence where they are a student of mine or a friend of mine or a family member of mine, then they'll end up finding that they feel a certain kind of way about music. They feel a certain kind of way about gospel music. And what I commonly find is that, for instance, at Tufts, my gospel choir is over 200 students, half of which are not religious, certainly. And some of them are proud atheists. Yet they join a gospel choir to learn more about a culture that's they're unfamiliar with. And I have hundreds of emails from students who came in non-Christian, and had their perspective switched and changed because they were allowed to experience something that was outside of their culture. And I also teach that people, you know, music is spiritual, period. And you can't cut your spiritual the spiritual part of your nature out. You can claim to not be spiritual, you can claim to not believe in God, but you can't cut the spiritual experience out. That being said, when you feel something in music, there's a name for that, especially when you feel so moved to, you know, cry, or when you feel a need to just raise your hand. Even if you're at a rock concert, people are like, that's worship. And you know, we're made to worship. We're hardwired to worship. In fact, everybody worships something. And I tell people that, you know, like, you can get away from a particular denomination or a faith in God, but you can't get away from worship. Worship is simply adoring something or loving it. We adore money. We adore our family. We adore ourselves. We adore fashion. We adore a song or an artist. We adore something, even if it's just adoring being alone in isolation. We worship that. And we can't get around that. However, when we direct that worship towards God, or what you can conceive as God, or a higher power, or something bigger than you, which is another thing that all people can agree upon, is that even if you don't believe that there's a God, you can believe that there's something greater than you. There's something powerful greater than you. And even if that's a group of people, which is more powerful than you alone, and a choir is that. It's a group of people that is higher and a higher power than you will as an individual, then when you put your worship, that energy that you use to worship other things into that, which is could be your love for that music or your love for that song or your love for this choir, it transforms you and it activates that spiritual part of you. And I would just argue for them that, you know, that's a human experience. Worship is a human experience. It's not supernatural to worship something. It's quite secular and quite human to do that. And there's no reason to ignore or poof or poo-poo on someone who's actually imagining a divine or a sacred being that's a part of that relationship that you're having with that worship. People have different experiences. And I've also met plenty of atheists who ended up being the best, craziest Christians. And I've met plenty of Christians who ended up being the most staunch atheists. You know, people are on their journey. And the last thing I'll say is that people are on different journeys. Their journey is for them, not for you. And it's certainly not for you to judge. And I certainly wouldn't expect anyone to judge me for believing in God. I certainly don't judge anyone for not. Let life take its course for you and see where it takes you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We have, David, there are two questions that are posted in the chat. They're big questions and we only have 2 minutes. So, you know, you see H.S. Jones and then Monica Spencer, maybe you could address those and then we'll be done with the question session.
You have 2 second answers to both of them. No. See, any thoughts on how to promote women's artistic production control in the midst of lingering male dominance, the capitalist driven system that tells us what is good to one like? The internet, independent business, independent spirit. If you put it out there and you can get it out there, and that's one of the greatest gifts of the internet, you can quickly, way more quickly alter and change the status quo of the established music industry than the way it is. Women need to educate themselves on how to produce music, how to write music, and how to and perform music. And YouTube is a powerful mechanism. A lot of independent rap artists are making a living by promoting themselves without having a record deal. That would have been unheard of 30 years ago. That's how women are doing it now. They're getting out there. If you are relying on the industry to put you out there, then you're right. You're right in the lion's den of a horrible patriarchal system, and they're going to tell you what it takes for you to succeed in that industry. And Monica, you have stated that the women's movement has paralleled the civil rights in many ways. How and when do people of African descent begin to authentically represent themselves in theater? Ooh, that's a whole different topic, Monica. Black people in theater, we'd have to go through minstrelsy and blackface and vaudeville, because that's when blacks were first allowed on stage in the 20s. And their journey of getting beyond the stereotypicals of the pickaninnies and the step and fetchets, representation on television as well as on radio, Amos and Andy. I mean, that's an entire different subject. But Blacks are still fighting to get on stage, just as women are still fighting in the world of theater. You know, like I said, these are very recent concepts, especially in straight theater, not musical theater. A woman to get on stage and tell her own story, you know, those are rare instances. They're there, but they're not as popular as one might believe, and they're certainly not as sought after. And the big women plays that have survived have been because women were the force behind them, which is why men need to step up and to make those things happen. Same goes for Blacks on stage. We've had our musicals, we had The Wiz, we have Hamilton, we have things, but those are just flashes, you know, in time. There's no real solidified representation for anybody other than what we're used to seeing on stage. And art houses all over the world, from symphony orchestras to theaters, are having to face this, especially this year, in the face of the anti-racist movement that's been going on in our country, and people realizing that they're programming white artists, their audiences are mostly white, and they're only promoting to those audiences as well. So it's a lot of work to be done from artistic organizations to help spread the word and to increase the patronage of the diversity of the patronage of the arts. Thank you, everybody, for your questions.
Thank you, David, so much for this wonderful presentation. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. It's been a pleasure to start off our colloquium series this way. Wonderful job. We'll make sure we've got the chat taken. Really appreciate everybody joining us. And thank you so much, David. Just terrific. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.